heart is a blue, shoots up through the stony ground. There's no room, no space to rent in this town. You're out of luck, and the reason that you had to care, the traffic is stuck, and you're not moving anywhere. You thought you'd found a friend to take you out of this place, someone you can lend a hand in return for grace. It's a beautiful.
All of my dreams are a heartbeat away. Yes, indeed, and welcome here to Newmarket. And they say that down in this neck of the woods that time doesn't always matter. Well, it's the first time in a long time that I've seen a game start before time. We started a couple of minutes early, and we're 15 or 16 seconds into it, and making the first attack here at the strong main for Rockchapel. David O'Leary, we need over there for, not David O'Leary, I should say, but Martin Casey. Casey playing it inside as far as PJ Murphy. Murphy looking up and bring it back as far as Martin Casey, the wing forward, who lays it out to one of the midfielders. His kick is half locked down, but right coming out there is Bernard Breen, the kick game left corner back. He gives it to centre-back Donny Anglin. Anglin gives it to an attacking midfielder who gets fouled there. The referee blowing the whistling, giving a free, and the free is on its way already over there to the far side of the field. Kishgame, and they're all black, this familiar outfit that has graced the fields of Cork for the past couple of seasons when they were bidding to win a junior county. That eluded them, but they have six Duhalla titles, so two have the men of Rockchapel, and Kishgame making their first attack. The ball dropping superbly, but caught superbly inside by Colin Murphy, a strong Rockchapel fullback. He gets it out the field. Good start to the game by Rockchapel. The ball played across here. Can they get possession? They have possession, and possession in the hands of Mossy Leahy. Good play by Leahy as he tries to walk his way forward, and then laying it off as far as centre-back Philip Murphy. Murphy then has the ball lost and taken away from him by Donny Anglin. Donny Anglin half gets away, but it's retrieved by Murphy. Murphy give it to the far side of the field. This is strong play where it comes as far as the Emilian Holland Tomás O'Mahony dropping this one for the first wide of the day. He'd be hoping for a better success rate than that. And that gives us the break and play, gives us an opportunity to give you the team. Lining out on the programme, Kishgame. Samuel Sullivan is their cool baller. The full back line is James O'Connor. Morris Anglin is the team captain, and Bernard Breen. The half back line sees Seamus Murphy, Donny Anglin, and Declan Crimmin. In the middle of the pack, we have Padraig O'Leary and Eamon O'Mahony. The half forward line sees David O'Leary, John Hurley, and John Anglin. Donald Hurley, Billy Dinahy, and Niall Cronin are the full forward line. And the ball, ball is from the kick out, going out over the line, and the line ball is taken. And will it go back out over the line? It will, and that's a poor ball there from Tomás O'Mahony, the centre forward for Rockchapel. He'd be disappointed about that one. Early stages in this particular match. The Rockchapel team in goal, we've got Tony Collins, the full back line, Conor Gainey, Colin Murphy, and TJ O'Callaghan. The half back line, David Murphy, Philip Murphy, and Morris Murphy. The middle of the path, Paul Murphy, probably their best known player. He's partnered by John Francis Murphy. I've never seen so many Murphys in a team. And a heavy challenge coming in there. The referee spotting it, and a free to the Kishgame to be taken by wing forward Martin Casey. I think we will have had half forward line. Martin Casey's there, Tomás O'Mahony and Mossy Leahy. The full forward line, Anthony O'Donnell, Geoffrey Collins, and PJ Murphy. And the Kishgame in winning position there, foul and a free to there, David O'Leary. Leary trying to send it up. I think it's John Hurley that's about to win possession. He was suspended for the last match, but he's back in action today. The pass there going straight, and it's intercepted by Morris Murphy. Murphy playing it back, and then a huge kick out the field coming right down here underneath. There's one initially by Martin Casey, who plays it further inside, but out comes Morris Anglin. How much football has this man played for both Duhallow and his club Kishgame? A ball across the field. This is an opportunity maybe for Kishgame to get their opening score. Niall Cronin, he was in the Duhallow team earlier this season. Lovely ball across the field from him. He got inside a defender. It comes as far as John Hurley. Hurley can lay it off. He succeeded in laying it off as far as Donald Hurley's ball. And I was going to say it was wide, but it's kept in play there. Good play by the Rockchapel men. And coming away from them is Paul Murphy. Give it inside. Good play as they walk it forward. And now comes as far as John Francis Murphy, John F. Murphy. I presume this fence. I'll have to talk to John Fintan Daly about all of that in a minute. He's the local historian expert down here. As Kishgame go attacking. The ball inside towards Big Thomas Dinahy, the full Billy Dinahy, the full forward. Can he get down and win his first possession in the game? And looking there for a free, didn't get it on that occasion. As he gets the ball out, I thought he may have got one. And The referee spotted that and he'll give a free in, and young Billy Hiddenahy, that'll be a good start for him. I'm joined in commentary by John Fintan Daly. John, you've seen a lot of Duhalla finals, and of course this brings the two big guys in Jonah football in this neck of the woods together.
Yeah, Paddy, these are the two farm teams of this championship, albeit that Kiss Game had to utilise the backdoor system actually to get out of round one against Mill Street. That was a bit of a blip, but they're in here with a vengeance. They have the three from Niall Cronin. Very good off a freeze, Paddy, with both Kiss Game and with Duhalla earlier this year. That's a good score from Niall Cronin from the far side. And I would remind you, Paddy, this match is actually on in Kentuck. I think we might have mentioned Newmarket earlier on, and that would have been a bone of contention because a lot of clubs were looking for this game. This is the second big match here in recent times because, as you know, we commented here as well in Naver Bond and Clyde Rovers earlier on. But the big crowd is coming in, Paddy. Started before time. I suppose that must be due to the diligence of Michael Scanlon. It isn't often that these games can start on time, but it's before time. John Hurley, the one addition to Kiss Game team, started at centre half forward and in a direct replacement for John Doody, Paddy. Very little in this, but Kiss Game has started the better and they've got the ball at midfield and they're certainly settling that bit better.
Yes, our apologies to the Kentuck J Club. We are no doubt about it where we are, so our apologies to both Kentuck and Newmarket if we create a little problems early on. That free going over the bar, as we said, for Niall Cronin is the opening and only score of the game so far. We are 5 minutes into it. And Kiss Game come attack here again. Good play by them as they will try and work it inside. But the Rock Chapelmen, their top defenders are coming down as John Hurley, the centre half forward. Hurley holding up a little bit, set up an attack a couple of minutes ago, and then did a good hand pass to get away with that one. And Billy Dean, he let it inside. This time it's caught by the goalkeeper Tony Collins, the Rock Chapel cool ball, and let it out to the far side of the field. Who's going to get it over there? The ball is going to break, and it's going to be won by, I think it's Paul Murphy. Murphy leaving it behind, and a little bit of short passing going over there in the right half back position. Then it's relieved up the field. A long ball up there, but only to be cut out by Donny Anglin, the centre back. Anglin give it in as far as Paddy O'Leary, the midfielder. O'Leary driving forward, and O'Leary is fouled, and there's a free to Kiss Game. The free is already on its way. In towards the tall target man, the young full forward. This is going to be a day of destiny for him, let me tell you, because, well, he's young in years, and I'm sure the Rock Chapel will have some trick up their sleeves for him as the Rock may come attacking him. He said this mark could hop over. One of the players decided to just hop over, and here comes the fellas, PJ Murphy. Murphy then laying it off to the onrushing player, but there was a foul there, and the referee, Donald Roach, who had a unique distinction of being involved with the Castle Magna team that won the Junior B Football League final here as a curtain raiser to this game. They beat Fremont on a scoreline of 1-6-6, and in the county championship next week, well, they travel to meet Belgoli in that particular match. So the referee, Donald Roach, a former midfield hurler, there's a free in here to be taken by Martin Casey, and Casey striking this one over the bar, of course. So we've got a pint apiece from the two free takers. Niall Cronin getting one and Martin Casey getting the other, and I suppose John free taker so important, and may come down to it today as well.
Yeah, and last year, Paddy, in the Duhalla final, Rock Chapel came back and won a great championship, beating Borby in the final. Martin Casey had a lot to say in that from free taking. Niall Cronin at the other side won't be found wanting off the hand, and these are two free takers that kick off the hand, Paddy, and are quite good at it, despite the fact a lot of free take off the hand nowadays can be considered of the risky variety. Good score by them, good settle for Rock Chapel, defending champions, with Kiss Game, the team, Paddy, that have won five titles in 7 years before that, three county finals, will be very much up for this, Paddy. There's going to be very little in it, and it's really an open match, Paddy. Very, very early in the game yet, very hard to see any pattern developing so far.
We've got a line ball here. The line ball is taken aside. Good play by the Rock Chapelmen. The score is a point apiece here. And the ball is won by the John Murphy there, the team captain, Murphy David, across the field. And as they're about to get their second score, walking their way inside there is Anthony O'Donnell. And Anthony O'Donnell is fouled. And there will be a free end to the Rock Chapelmen. Quite an amount of frees in the early stage of this game. And remember, of course, we'll have coverage of the other two junior championship games. We've the South. Oh, and a shot pass there. But it did work out for the Rock Chapelmen. And it comes as far as Mossy Leahy. And Mossy Leahy from a way out the field, lashing this one in, and it goes off for the second or third wide of the second wide, I think, if I'm not greatly mistaken, for the Rock Chapelmen. The wind, John, a little no rain here, thankfully. A lot of people talking about rain. Met a fella this morning who told me that the sheep were going up the hill a little bit higher than they would be if rain was expected, so hopefully the sheep are an indication that the rain may stay away, but with the wind still a considerable factor.
Yeah, well, down here on Kentuck, Paddy, they don't have any sheep. I think they consider themselves to be on the real lowlands of this part of Duhalla, Paddy. I don't really know about that, but certainly on a more serious note, this game is very evenly balanced. Eamon Mahoney on the ball at the moment, just back from Australia after a year away. That ball is fired out, or helped out over the line by TJ O'Callaghan. Big crowd, Paddy, has to come into the far side of the field. It's going to be a very close game. Two teams who have great experience of winning at this level, and certainly, Paddy, Donald Roach has called that ball back. The ball was heading towards Billy Dennehy, another very young player, only 19. He's marking Colin Murphy, brother of Paul Murphy of Rock Chapel. Two big men there, full forward and full back. A lot of ball going in there today, and certainly whoever gets control here in midfield is going to have a big bearing in the party, because both of them are teak tough. And this game, you can be absolutely sure, I believe, will go right down to the wire.
And then that man Murphy wins it again and plays it out the field. Where it come those fellas, Paul Murphy, brothers combining. Paul Murphy leaving it across the side of the field here, where it's won by centre forward Tommaso Manny. Manny looking up and then leaving it long inside towards Rock Chapel, mid paying it long and high in the air. Bookish game winning that one back, and it comes as far as Donny Anglin and working his way out and trying to find the right half back Seamus Murphy there. The referee spotting the infringement, the free is already taken right close to the sideline here. It will go out over the line, and certainly quite a number of line balls, and the line ball now is going to be taken by Martin Casey, the free taker. But he's away back in his own 65 metre line, and Casey then decides to take a shot as far as Tomas O'Mahony, centre forward O'Mahony letting it long once more towards the full forward line inside, but all of those have been cut out by Morris Anglin in the early stages of the match. It's a point apiece. We are, where are we gone? 10 minutes gone in this one. The ball went up the field by Kish Game, is played into the hands of their corner forward, Donal Herlihy. And Herlihy give it towards the big full forward, Billy Dinehy looking up, and then a lovely hand pass out the field where he gives it as far as David O'Leary. And O'Leary with the left foot, is he going to add to the wide sadly? Can he be kept in play? I think it's going to be kept in play, but it's going to be kept in play by Kish Game, or it comes as far as maybe John Anglin is the player that has it over there as far as I can gather. And John Anglin plays it out the field where it's won out by John Herlihy. Herlihy give it in to Eamon O'Mahony, the man who's returned from Australia. That one is going out for another wide ball. This time the wide accruing to Kish Game, and the scoreboard remaining a point and no score. And I would suggest to you, John, that the Rock Chapelmen seem to have a more direct approach. Long foot passing seem to be the main characteristic of their style of play.
Yes, and they also operate with the midfielder John Francis Murphy, captain of the team, or he's known actually for shot party. It's Freddie, I don't know why, but that's what he's always known as. And Thomas Mahoney, who's now operating at centre field, they operate them back and forth, and they switch often. And at the moment, Thomas Mahoney's playing in midfield. They will play more direct in Kish Game. Kish Game will play the ball a bit shorter, but certainly both teams are reasonably direct party, and among the shot passing is little enough, and both teams are trying to open the game up.
Both teams and the other wins it there is Donal Herlihy trying to find the full forward once again. Who's going to get that? I wonder, will it be Colin Murphy? And Murphy's beaten this time by Billy Dinehy. And Dinehy having difficulty getting the ball up off the ground. He got it up off the ground. He gave it back as far as John Herlihy. Did John Herlihy put it over the bar? I wonder. And John Herlihy, a little bit of a dispute. I think that one did go over the bar for the second point of the game. Coming from John Herlihy, the man who was back after suspension. He missed the last match against Drumtariff, the semi final. On that occasion, Kish Game winning 3-11 to 1-12. Well, here, Kish Game lead by 2 points to. 2 points to one, and certainly the interesting duel that is occurring is between Billy Dinehy from Kish Game in at full forward and his direct marker Colin Murphy, John.
Yeah, two very big men, Paddy. One far more experienced, obviously, than the other. Colin Murphy would be in his mid-20s now. Billy Dinehy won that last one, but he kind of slipped and he got a heavy shoulder charge, a legitimate one, let me say, but it got down to John Herlihy, and from a very acute angle, he got the ball over the bar. I noticed that a linesman party in the far side are indicating the ref, but the ref hasn't seen him.
Yes, the linesman is calling over there, and he must have spot some little bit of infringement on or off the ball, and I think the linesman has forgot about it now, maybe, but there's a free here. Tickish game and a free on their own 65-metre line. Well, they do it. They play at the far side of the field over there, and Kish Game trying to build to get more scores, and the ball working well inside, running out with there is John Anglin. Can Anglin win it? I wonder. He hops it on the ground, and he gets it up, but the second time of asking Anglin, they are trying to evade a couple of tackles, and evade Rock Chapelman is a skill in itself, working inside, and the ball cut out, and good defending it is with Paul Murphy. Paul Murphy, the midfielder, and Paul Murphy give it across the half-back line, where it's won by Philip Murphy. Murphy give it this side of the field now, where it's won by John Francis Murphy, operating at centre half-hour now for the last couple of minutes, and John Francis Murphy driving up the field here. Who's going to get out and run onto it, I wonder? With Martin Casey there hoping to get with, but running down there, and the referee said that the free is into the Rock Chapelmen, and the free to be taken by Tomas O'Mahony. O'Mahony's already taken this one. Good free outside to the far side of the field as they try to build, and he comes out as far as Martin Casey. What's Casey going to do? Give it back as far as Mossy Leahy, and Leahy from away out the field. The goalkeeper is equal to it, and the goalkeeper is Sam O'Sullivan, and runs into a little bit of difficulty, Sam O'Sullivan, but eventually gets it out as far as Donny Anglin, and away come Kish Game. Remember, they were in 3 county junior football finals during the 90s, and they were beaten all of those, but all of that doesn't matter one whit of difference now, because this is the real local situation here. The Duhalla Junior football finalists won inside again by Billy Hedinihy. He's a good bit off on goal and he's trying to get inside and he's gone past Colin Murphy and he lays off a good pass inside and just over the bar there and a good ball in there from David O'Leary with the player in question. So again, Billy Hedinihy, he was the author there, manufacturer, 3 points to no score in favour of the 3 points to one in favour of the Kishkamian. So with 14 minutes gone here, it's Kishkam who lead. Kishkam 3 points, Rockchapel one. For the moment, back to the studio. Kick out on its way from the Rockchapel goalkeeper, John Fintan-Daly. Another good score there coming from wing forward on that occasion.
Yeah, very good score from David O'Leary and a lot of the spade work done by Billy Dinhy initially and Donny Hurley before that. Good score party, very well taken. Rockchapel are finding it more difficult to get into scoring areas. That's a good ball now from Massey Leahy after playing it into Thomas O'Mahony and he's on the attack here.
Tomas O'Mahony and Tomas O'Mahony block, half block down there, but will be cut off by the Kishkamian and will come into the hands of centre back Donny Anglin. Anglin working it forward. Good player by the men in black. It's the drive forward, and it comes as far as corner forward, and the corner forward wins it is Donal Herley. Herley, he give it inside once again, and away Kishkamian playing the better football earlier on in this occasion, but there another wide ball coming off Niall Cronin. Would have been expected to do a little better, I would suggest, on that occasion. 3 points to one, John.
Yeah, absolutely, Paddy. Niall Cronin, of all the forwards, would have been expected to be very accurate, and he won the ball. Did exactly the right thing with it, turned, was no more than 25 metres out, and from a pretty good angle, party. I've often seen him score from very tight angles, wide, and he'd be very disappointed with that, party, because they certainly have the run at the moment. They're 3 points to one up, and certainly the game going their way right now.
The Rockchapel men have switches made in their full forward line and half forward line. We'll talk about those a little bit later on, but here is Kishkamian who come forward once again, but cut off there. Colin Murphy trying to get the ball out the field, and the Kishkamian win it back. Now Rockchapel have it, holding it up a little bit, then ballooning it out the field where it's going to be caught, I think, with all these all by Seamus Murphy. Seamus Murphy giving it inside to another midfielder, and that midfielder is Eamon O'Mahony. Eamon O'Mahony's far as centre back, and did he overcarry a wonder? This time he didn't, then he lifted off to the far side of the field where Niall Cronin is trying to run onto it there, and Cronin does succeed in keeping it in play, but only into the hands of his direct marker, who's Conor Guiney. Guiney give it as far as left half-back David Murphy. David Murphy give it in as far as midfielder John Francis Murphy. Team captain Murphy is slowing it and then soling it and then giving it long inside. And the boy Anglin comes out. There's a little bit of a push in the back, but gone back there to cover is Bernard Breen. Left corner back, Bernard Breen. Then across the half-back line where it's picked up by centre half-back and he gives it on to midfielder. Yeah, Paul de O'Leary. Good play by O'Leary. Let it off at the left foot to the far side of the field. Who's going to win it over there, I wonder, as three or four players combine, and it's won by Paul Murphy. Murphy usually leaves it off at the left foot, and he's a good left foot, but straight into the hands on that occasion there of Seamus Murphy. Murphy walking up the field where now it has come by John Herley. Herley give it to Dinehy, and Dinehy, lovely ball inside where it comes to Ferris. Eamon O'Mahony blazing down on goal, an absolutely unbelievable miss. A yard wide as he blazes on goal. Maybe should have opted to go over there. There was a goal chance there at the taking. No out the wall, it's 3 points to one still in favour of Kishkamian, but a goal opportunity went to Biggin. Rockchapel will be pleased to see that one go where it did.
Absolutely, Paddy, and that was started by Paddy O'Leary, I believe, initially. Gave it to Billy Dinehy, and he certainly cool head there, drove the defence, cleared it in over the top. Eamon Mahoney coming through like a train, and badly kicked, Paddy, I suppose. To be fair to Eamon Mahoney, he's probably been out of the country for quite a while, mightn't have played at this level or quite at this pace of a game. Rockchapel are going to be there right to the end, and scores like that are going to be important. We know what happened in Croke Park last Sunday when scores haven't taken, and certainly Rockchapel will try and get themselves back in. They badly need a score, Paddy, at this stage.
They need a score. Will they get one or not by this very, very good defender here? Seamus Murphy playing very, very well indeed. A right half-back picking up a lot of loose play and picking that one up right down at the corner there. Running into a little bit of difficulty and playing the ball out the field. Where is one further on there by Paddy O'Leary giving it back, and away come Kishkamian as they try to build from behind, and this time it's with Donal Hurley. Very close to sideline, but Rockchapel win it back where it comes to Tomas O'Mahony, who's operating out the field there now. And Tomas O'Mahony's pass on that occasion left a little bit to be desired, and the ball out over the line. So a line ball to Kishkamian. It's 3 points to one in favour of the Kishkamian. Up the field it goes again, and Dinehy is winning that one, and well played by Dinehy. A good playmaker and laying it off, good tackle man, and then he lays it off as far as Donal Hurley. And Hurley's pass inside is cut off, and it eventually comes as far as Morris Murphy, who's coming this side of the field. And Paul Murphy has it. And welcome back here to listeners of County Sound, 103 in the county, 102.6 in the city, and the ball working in the field where it comes as far as Martin Casey. What's Casey going to do? He's got the only point of the game for the Kishkamian, and they're coming inside and over the bar. A fabulous point there from Massey Leahy to make it now 3 points to Kishkame, 2 points to the men of Lochchapel. The only score, you didn't miss any score while you were away. You just came back at the right time for probably the score of the match from Mossy Lee. A very good move into the score that was badly wanted, I suppose, from a Lochchapel point of view, John Fintan Daly.
Yeah, and as I was saying before, while the listeners were away, Paddy, Eamon Mahoney at the other end missed a great goaling opportunity. And as I said, Armagh proved last Sunday that if the other team doesn't take that chance, they'll come at you with a vengeance, and Lochchapel will do that. And they certainly come back into a game, Paddy, where there were 3 or 4 points down on the possession stakes, but they're only 1 point down on the play. That's what counts. This ball is going to go back out of the line right here under us. Donny Herlihy, he got out with it out here over the Lochchapel side of the field, and I think it's being, I don't know, there may be some sort of an injury here to Lochchapel player. The linesman has the ball, but certainly it's being hotly contested, Paddy. Only 1 point in it, and this game is really up at stake, Paddy, for anyone.
Yes, John Moore is the well-known linesman in the side of the field, giving that line ball to the men of Lochchapel, but coming out with it, and Morris Anglin, good play by Anglin, lays off a tackle, and then gives this fella Seamus Murphy the wing back. Murphy goes to ground, but has cop on enough to get up and lay off the pass before he does his recovery. Ball across the field, John Herlihy, the centre forward for Kishkame, should win this. Does good play by Herlihy, a lovely ball to the far side of the field, into the corners for Niall Cronin, well picked up by Cronin, it must be said, and the scoreboard says 3 points to 2. We are, what have we got, 19 minutes, and then it comes as far as Donal Herlihy. Herlihy give it further inside now, where it's won by David O'Leary, and David O'Leary working his way forward. The jersey was caught there, referee, and no advantage of Crowe, and the ball went off out for a wide ball, and that's about the 6th or 7th wide of the game so far, even though I thought, to be fair to Donal Herlihy, there was a little bit of tugging of the jersey on that occasion, and no advantage accrued to him, John Fintan.
Yeah, I suppose the referee just left a go, Paddy, but certainly Kishkame have got into possession there, and have found it very hard to shake off Lochchapel defence. That's no surprise, because Lochchapel have a reputation for being very tight defenders. Donny Herlihy was involved in that one, and Niall Cronin before him, and finally with David O'Leary, and he maybe was pulled very slightly, but he did manage to get in his kick. He win wide, Paddy, and again, there's still only 1 point in it, and Lochchapel are hanging in there the whole time.
Yes, and the latest we have from the Ryder Cup is a very, very good start to the singles by the Europeans. They lead in a scoreline of 11.5 to 9.5, but still a number of matches to go there. The ball worked inside. The Kishkame boys are really worried about the Ryder Cup. It's 3 points to 2 in favour of them. The ball now comes as far as Tomas O'Mahony, the midfielder. He's working forward up the field as far as Anthony O'Donnell. O'Donnell is fouled. 46 or some more metres out, 64 or 5 metres out by the sideline, and the man who's going to take this free is Tomas O'Mahony himself, standing over there just 4 or 5 metres in from the sideline, and he will look up. He will be happy enough with the scoreline, because Kishkame have been the dominant side, no doubt about that, but there's only a point between them. Jonah Football, this is all what superbly inside by PJ Murphy, and PJ Murphy's attempt at doing something was cut off there by the Kishkame, and now it comes as far as Eamon O'Mahony. O'Mahony giving forward, and away come the Lochchapelmen in the person there of David O'Leary, a point scorer. David O'Leary working forward again towards that interesting duel above, and the interesting duel is that Billy Dinney has it, players left, right, front and centre. He's by the pot, John Herlihy. Herlihy, more of a playmaker than a scorer. What's he going to do here? Will he use his playmaking skills, or will he try and score? Well, he's doing a little bit of soling around. He does a lot of this kind of crack, and he's still driving forward. Maybe he'll fist this one. He does fist it, and the ball is coming in and just out for a wide ball off a second fist, one fist across to the other, another wide ball. I think that's wide number 8, John.
Yeah, it was David O'Leary started that move, Paddy, and again Kishkame were forcing the pace, again controlling possession, but not getting the scores at the end. And let me tell you, they are not they are not known for that sort of thing. Kishkame usually are good to take their scores. Lochchapel will be happy enough they're holding them at bay. That finished with John Herlihy cutting inside at the angle, punchy it for the score, which is the right thing to do in that situation. And Niall Cronin at the far side, it was badly directed at the far side, he punched it, Paddy, but it went wide, and another let off for Lochchapel.
Lochchapel selectors here in front of us, Joe Collins, Tom Carroll and Jerry O'Mahony. They are deciding to ring the changes, getting one of their replacements to warm up. But this Kishkame were doing all the good play. Their lead though only in a single score, 3 points. They won, the ball is won by Donal Herlihy. Herlihy making his way towards goal, soaring with the left, he can kick with the left or right, and a heavy tackle there. The referee said that it was all legitimate, and well, whether it was legitimate or not, he had to give the ball away, and he gave it back to a Lochchapelman, and the Lochchapelman that has it now is Martin Casey walking forward. Good play by Lochchapel as they try and get another score to add to the two they'll already have. And PJ Murphy, who's done quite good work since he's moved into the corner, and Murphy there doing a little bit of an interchange with the full forward Jeffrey Collins, and he is fouled, and there's going to be a free in, and maybe this gives an opportunity for Lochchapel to bring in their sub. And the person that's coming on there for Lochchapel is Ian Guiney, the player coming in, and We'll wait a second to see who the player is going off. It seems to be a forward up there. And the man to take the free is Martin Casey. Has already scored one, the two-wing forward. And Casey getting ready to lob this one. What does he do with it? He puts it over the bar and the sides are level. And Rockchapel will be pleased, John Fintan Daly, to be level on the scoreline at 3 points apiece, considering that this game have... Well, I won't say own the ball, but have a quite amount of possession.
Yes, Paddy, and Tom Carroll has made repair moves there to try and give more potency to his attack. They've removed Geoffrey Collins, who had seen very little of the ball early on. And interestingly enough, Paddy, they move one of their big guys in full forward now. Massey Leahan has gone straight in full forward. Ian Guiney has come on in the corner, it would appear to me. And that's going to make a difference to them up front. They're going to try and pump more ball in straight, Paddy. They're levelling this game, and they're certainly tearing in third, Paddy, with less possession.
And tearing into the edge there as the ball taken away from him, but they're returning back again with PJ Murphy. And Murphy is, fouled, did a little bit of fouling there. And the Kishkemen, who had one possession from him, the Kishkemen was fouled and free to them. The free is already taken. It comes out as far as David O'Leary. David O'Leary hand passing it on further as far as Seamus Murphy, the wing back. Murphy coming forward. Good play by Murphy. Strong young player moving forward still and going past the Mosso Man as if he didn't exist on that occasion. And now give it in as far as Patrick O'Leary. O'Leary looking up, and what's O'Leary going to do with it? Give it back as far as John Hurley. Hurley decides that he'll add to the wides tally. Not too sure how many wides we've had, but I would suggest that we've at least 7 or 8 wides, John. I'd say you've missed one or two of them. I know when you're doing your billing back in your office, you miss things like that, but Kishkem, without doubt, have the greater amount of possession, and they're missing some that they should slot over the bar.
Yes, Paddy, we'll leave that comment go by, and we'll go on to the next one, but I actually believe there are only 5 or 6 wides. They've had an awful lot of possession, and on a more serious note, and might appear to have more wides, but a lot of the ball, Paddy, never actually ended up over the ball line at all, and that one from John Hurley was another missed time one, and not quite on target, but Rockchapel, fantastic party, a grindy out teams, a bit Armagh-like in that respect. You can see it there yourself. Paul Murphy got to that one with his game and one possession back, and they're working down for Donny Yang, then down towards Donny Hurley here on the right wing.
Hurley has it, and the ball went forward again toward the full forward. This guy is good, let me tell you, Billy Dean, he wins it there, and the ball pushed out over the, or gone out over the line, and there's so many little things that have gone the way of Rockchapel, and the Rockchapel men sponsored by the two pubs in the village, and I've never seen this operating before. Murphy's Bar and Penny Molly's, and they on the front of their jerseys they have the Rockchapel Vintners. That's the way they operate, and I'm sure that other clubs could run like that, take a few bob off the whole lot of them. Working forward there, the Rockchapel men, there with a foul there, surely there was a foul, and the man that's fouled was Anthony O'Donnell, I think is the player in question there. So the free take it will be Martin Casey, who has already scored one free or two frees for them, and an opportunity now for him to put Rockchapel into the lead, coming to the 26th minute of the game. And Rockchapel are making moves around the middle of the field. And Tommaso Manny, I think, is moving back maybe in central forward. John Finty making the point that they do this quite a lot. And the free to be taken by Martin Casey. He'll be pleased with his start. An easy one and a difficult one, this one, by the time he brings it in, and it's heading in that general direction, and a very, very good kick. And I think, John, we mentioned somewhere early on about free takers, but this guy seems to be doing the business. 4-3 in favour of the Rock.
Well, I did say that at the start, Paddy, that both free takers would not be found wanting. They generally aren't. Martin Casey has now kicked 3 out of 3. I don't believe he's missed one from scoreable range. Niall Cronin has been good at the other side, but hasn't seen half as many chances. Rockchapel grinding their way into the game, Paddy. John Francis Murphy gone back in centre forward, and Donny Anglin. Thomas O'Mahony is midfield. Eamon O'Mahony, interestingly enough, Paddy, the guy that's back from Australia, hasn't performed that well, and finding it difficult match practice wise, I imagine. But certainly Rockchapel are very much in there. They're getting breaks, although Padraig O'Leary has won this ball for Kiss Game in the middle of the field.
Padraig O'Leary wins it to the far side of the field, though, but the line got there before the intended recipient of that pass, Niall Cronin. So it's a line ball for Kishkem. Kishkem into the lead. 27 minutes gone. They've got the last 3 scores of the match from Mossy Casey and the two, Mossy Leahy and 2 from Martin Leary. Walking up the field, but Kishkem cut it off. Kishkem defenders marking rather tight, and the ball coming towards the John Hurley, but Hurley has the ball knocked away from him, gone out over the line, and the line ball to go to Crew in the favour of the Kishkem, and to be taken by John Anglin over there. John Anglin obviously will try to find a player in a better position and does find a full forward. Billy Dinehy will be quite pleased with his start of the game. Billy Dinehy lays the pass off there. There was a foul by one of the Rockchapel men coming through, so it's a free in to Kishkem and an opportunity for Niall Cronin, their free taker. He's already scored one and missed not a free but one missed one from play. An opportunity for him to tie the sides up as we come to the 28th minute of a half that has been both Entertaining and good value for money. The crowds are still coming in here, and we'll get an estimate. John Finton knows how to measure people over in this neck of the woods very well. We'll see what does he think of the crowd as Niall Cronin. What does he do with this one? Is it over the bar? It is from the corner forward, getting that one over, trying to size up. And to be fair, I think John is only what the Kish gamemen would feel that they deserve. They have an amount of possession. They size their level 4 points apiece.
They are, and he has, and Niall Cronin has been found wanting in the free taking department either party. As regards the crowd, to be honest with you, I was expecting a bigger crowd. Now, Ken Turk has a lot of terracing, as you can see, and it can take a huge crowd of people without it seeming that big. Certainly, the Duhalla hurling final drew an unusually big crowd because there was a football semi-final before it. That drew around 3,000 people. It's not as big as that today party. I imagine maybe around the 2,000 mark might be more like it. But certainly a great day for football party. Kiskeaman getting on top here now again. John Hurley playing this ball into number 12, John Anglin. They're on the attack again.
John Anglin moving forward. Anglin is going to the free, and Niall Cronin will come to take this one. Will this be the lead score, I wonder? And the referee, Donald Roach, the Castle Magnum man who had success with, Milford man who had success with Castle Magnum in the Junior B Football League that was played as a curtain raiser to this game. And I think it's TJ O'Callaghan who is giving his name to the red tour on this occasion. Seeing it's my first time commentating on a number of Rockchapel men, I'm not too sure whether his name has appeared in referee's notebooks before. A yellow card there for the corner forward there. The referee right up there with it. A free in to Niall Cronin. A bit further out than the last one. An opportunity for him, though, to put Kishgame into the lead as we come to the short whistle. 29 and a half minutes gone. And Niall Cronin already the scorer of 2 points for the Kishgame, and the other coming from John Hurley and David O'Leary. And Niall Cronin's kick is coming in. It's going to add to the wide tally, and that's greeted with great applause over there by the people of Rockchapel. They're not too worried about whether it is sporting or otherwise. So the size level, 4 points apiece. As we come to the top minute, the 30 minute, I think the referee is going to call for the half-time break. And so here at half-time, the score at the moment is Kishgame 4 points, Rockchapel 4. Back to you in the studio.
Second half, and the score is 4 points to 4 points.
Welcome back to the second half. It's Kishgame where they into the second half driving through, and an excellent save there. The goalkeeper, really, John Anglin, was driving through. The goalkeeper, Tony Collins, cut it out and out for a 45, and certainly it appeared that nothing was going to happen, but a very good run there indeed by John Anglin, and the goalkeeper had to be really, really alert to keep that one out. A 45 to accrue to the Kish game in to be taken by Padraig O'Leary, one of their midfielders. O'Leary looking up, and he will know that an improved performance by his side in the second half is absolutely vital if they are to win back this championship. They were champions a couple of years ago, but remember today they're playing the reigning champions. As we watch this man, Padraig O'Leary striking this one, decided to play it shot inside. Is that an indication of the wind, I wonder? And it's won there by Niall O'Leary. Niall Cronin was pushed in the back and a free in. Yes, indeed, and listeners to 103 FM in the county, 102 Pine Six in the city, welcome back here to Cantor for the second half of the Duhallow Junior football final. And it has just, the second half that has just begun, which was involved a fabulous save by the Rockchapel goalkeeper Tony Collins from John Anglin. The 40, out for a 45, the resultant 45, and the ball went towards the corner forward Niall Cronin. He was fouled and a free in, and Cronin himself is being asked to take this one. Thankfully, the rain is off. Whether the sheep are up on top of the hill or not, I'm not too sure. And out for a while. Wide ball, that's wide number 8. I think we're going to settle on the wide sally 8. And John Finton, a very, very good save by the Rockchapel goalkeeper there when John Engden was bearing down on top of him.
Yeah, now you wonder, would the longer the game goes on, Paddy, are they going to suffer for these wides? They have 8 wides now. They're getting 145, a rise out of which they got another free that Niall Cronin surprisingly missed, because he's normally very good on these. Rockchapel have only one wide, Paddy. They had the slight advantage of the win in the second half, and certainly one feels that his game need to bury this game soon if they're going to win it, because they can't keep missing scores like this.
The advantage now, though, is with the Rockchapel men. The scoreboard says 4 points apiece, and it's driven forward there, but right underneath it. Good centre back to only Angley for Kishkame. Angley giving it aside as far as Padraig O'Leary. O'Leary give it to Eamon O'Mahony. Remember, he was the man who will be credited with a miss in the first half when he was bearing down on goal. But Rockchapel backs are really tight, and it comes into the hand of full-back Colin Murphy. Murphy give it out to the brother, Paul Murphy. And Paul Murphy with the left foot letting it down inside, but coming out there to take it to back's game so far. Remember, 4 points apiece. That would give its own, tell its own story. Donald Hurley, he wins it. Hurley giving the ball across the field. Fockish game, but the ball taken away from him. It comes back inside the right half-back, Seamus Murphy, who had a very good first half, and he lays the back ball, the ball on to Donald Hurley. Hurley then laying it across the field over there to his brother, John Hurley. Then John Hurley decided to let the ball run on. He'll probably pick it up in the run. That he does with great perfection. And John Hurley walking his way inside, trying to get inside Philip Murphy, and he's out as far as the 30-metre line. Then he plays it out as far as Billy Dinahy, the full forward. Dinahy is grounded. There could be a booking there, but the referee, the Milford, former Milford hurler, not too worried about little indiscretions like that. So a free hit, whether Niall Cronin will go across to take this one or not, or we watch to see what way it is going to take. This one is David O'Leary. O'Leary's already got a point from play. This one to get the opening score of the second half, which is 3 minutes old, and this one has gone in, and off for another wide, and 9 wides now. And certainly we're going to get some scores from around the place. In Avenue, in the North Cork Junior Under 21 hurling final, it's a semi-quarter final. Newtown Shandrum 1-12, but it's Kilwort who have won it on the scoreline of 3-11, and that's certainly a little bit of a surprise. And the Newtown Shandrum men, they were favoured to do well in this particular championship. They're gone out of it now, and Kilwort are the guys who got through to the semi-final of the championship. Here it's the final of the North Cork Junior, not the North Cork, the Duhallow Junior Football Championship. It's 4 points apiece. We've yet to get the opening score of the second half. And the rain just about, I think, to make its appearance here in Kentuck for the first time in, a number of weeks, shall we say. The kick out is in around midfield. Normally does. Bobbling around the place. Picked up there. Good play by the Rockchapel man. The man that has it there is Paul Murphy. Murphy winning that one, and he is fouled. The referee's going to call a player over. I think it's John Hurley. He is going to become maybe the second player in this particular match. That's going to be booked with T.G. O'Callaghan from Rockchapel in the first half. And John Hurley now has his name been taken there by the referee, and judging by the amount of paperwork that's involved, I'd imagine we'll see his card of some description coming out, and the card has come out, so the free will be back behind his own 45 to be taken, I would imagine, maybe by Paul Murphy himself, as we watch here waiting for the first score of the second half. Murphy takes it as far as the man over there, Thomas Manny, and Thomas, who's got to wing forward, and he lays a lovely ball out to Conor Geaney. Geaney coming forward, and Geaney with the left foot, the corner back's left foot, and wide ball, the second wide for the Rockchapel men. Maybe that's the goal where the wides, but it was a good move by Rockchapel, and they would have been hoping for their first attack maybe to get that one over the bar, John.
Yeah, and on wide, Paddy, Kiss game of 7 wides to Rockchapel's 2. Hard to believe that Rockchapel is running their second wide of the whole game, because the scoring is much lower than anticipated. A day for backs, I think, despite the fact that the weather is very, very kind today, reasonably kind except for a bit of a wind, but certainly backs on both sides and top party. Both forward lines are highly rated, but certainly the backs are on top. Kiskeam after stealing that ball through John Anglin there out around the middle of the field. Referee gives another free to Kiskeam. One wonders how long they can go on wasting possession party without suffering for it.
We watch this one. Well, this free is out behind there on 60, 40, 65. They wouldn't be expecting to score for that, but the man driving forward now is Tony Anglin. Moving forward, Anglin is grounded, and Anglin is grounded outside the semicircle. And when Anglin went down, another Kiske, a Rock Chapman man, went down injured as well. Whether he fell of his own accord or whether it was he was assisted onto the ground. And I see that the Rock Chapel midders here, they would appear that they may have to make his move there because one of their players is down injured. But the medical staff would be first of all called into action, and hopefully for the man in question, he will be able to resume and take up his duties in there. And that's already on the way, and certainly to take a little bit more than a tumble to put on a Rock Chapel man. David Murphy with the player in question there. But Niall Crone is the man who's standing over this free. He's already kicked two frees. Does he kick another one? And the answer is he does. For the bar for Niall Cronin, he gets his third pointed free of the game. Martin Casey has three pointed frees for the Rock Chapelmen. It's Kiskeam who now lead on a scoreline of 5 points to four. And John, with a low scoring game, free taking I think is going to be vital. And also, I presume that the team that would get the first goal would be serious contenders then.
Yes, well, if there's going to be a first goal, because at the moment, party, both backs, sets of backs seem to be fairly well on top. Kiskeam were in for a goal chance of John Anglin earlier on, but Niall Cronin will be relieved to have got that one because he has missed a couple. David O'Leary missed one on the other side. And let me tell you that both of these free takers, David O'Leary and Niall Cronin, would be highly rated locally and, you know, are well able to kick frees from all sorts of angles and distances. Rockchapel are concerned now because they have an injury party out around the middle of the field. It would appear to me that this Mossy Leahy is down, number 12, and indeed it is. He's had to get up now. Remember, he was operating at full forward at one stage. There's a lot of switching going on. John Francis Murphy stays at midfield. Number 13, Anthony O'Donnell, appears to have come to centre-back, at least temporarily, and Mossy Leahy is also operating in midfield, and I wonder, Paddy, I think there's a third midfielder being operated now by Rockchapel.
Kick out on his way, Paul Murphy gathering it the first time, but then it falls into the hands of John Anglin, the Kiskeam, and John Anglin, the ball is being held there by a Rockchapel man as well. The referee says that he's looking for the ball back from the two guys in question. The latest we have from the Ryder Cup, it's 12.5 to 9.5 in favour of the Europeans, and maybe that was not expected, but a very, very good start in the singles matches. And these early single matches, but still a lot of play to go in that particular competition, as there is in this one. 5-4 to the men of Kiskeam. We're 6 or 7, 8 minutes into the second half. A long, high ball being lobbed in toward the full forward line. The side is broken down by Dinahy, but is collected by the fullback. There was Mackey, and the fullback is Colin Murphy. Laying it out to the centre half back, who's gone out to the right half back position to take it up. That's Philip Murphy. Over on the terrace side of the pitch here in Kentucky, plays it as far as Thomas Manny. Thomas Manny walking the ball up the field, but into the waiting hands there of Eamon O'Mahony, no relation. Eamon O'Mahony give it as far as John Hurley, but Donal Hurley going a little bit of a solo run, and then spotting a Kiskeam player on Matt outside, and a lovely ball inside. And could that be the score of the game from David O'Leary getting that one? His second point of the match. They're a 2-point margin now after creeping in between the sides. Rockchapel have yet to score in the second half, and these scores now proving crucial. What have we got in the Irish Southeast Division? We go to the Irish Life Junior B Football Championship Final. Belgooley 4 goals and 12 points. Kinsale 3 points. And remember, Belgooley, they represented the Southeast Division next week when they play Castle Magner in the County Junior B Football Championship. But here, it's the Kiskeam men who are piling on the pressure. They lead Rockchapel in a scoreline of 6 points to four. Rockchapel, having only had their one attack during the entire course of the second half, which is 9 minutes old. But there's a second attack coming up. Maybe a score with a crew from Scott superbly inside by PJ Murphy. Murphy laying it off as far as Thomas Manny. Thomas Manny, lovely ball across the field, but is cut off by Anglin, and away come the Kiskeamen in the person of Eamon O'Mahony. Eamon O'Mahony working the ball forward up the field towards Niall Cronin. Niall Cronin with a good player by Cronin. The Duhalla player and Cronin leave it back to O'Mahony once again. O'Mahony moving forward, driving forward with panache and style, and then laying off the hand pass. And the hand pass to the person in question is the big full forward, and a wide ball from him. He didn't even look where he was kicking on that occasion, but it wasn't too far off the mark. He's done well, the youth at full forward, but that's good play. And the Kiskeamen, I think, playing a little bit better now, John, there 50%, if you like, ahead on a low-scoring game, 6 points to four, they're ahead.
Yeah, but the game itself, Paddy, I'll have to confess, is disappointing. I was expecting a better game. Players seem to be cancelling one another out. Paul Murphy has been fouled there by Eamon O'Mahony. Players like Paul Murphy don't appear to be making the impact on Morrisanglan at the other side that one would have hoped for. This game needs a few stars and a few individual bits of brilliance to open it up. And certainly Rock Chapel are coming at him, Paddy, but they've made no attempt to score yet in the second half, and they barely need a score to stay in touch.
Rockchapel walking the ball up the field and is cut off once again by the Kishgame defenders. So Kishgame will be happy up to mop up the pressure and hopefully get a few more scores. John Hurley back from the forward division to help out his defence, and he now gives it to the right half-back, David Murphy. Murphy coming forward. Murphy giving it inside, and good play by the Kishgame, and as they work it back. It comes to Thomas Manny. Thomas Manny always looking up and then the ball inside, but is cut off once again by centre half-back, and good player Donny Anglin. Donny Anglin coming into midfield, the ball coming into midfield, where it's won by Padraig O'Leary. Padraig O'Leary give it over there, where it's kept in play, if you like, by Billy Dinihy, and Dinihy work it on, and what's this one, has got over the bar, and a very good score indeed. Donal Hurley with the player in question getting that one over, but it was good work by Billy Dinihy to make it now 7 points to four, and very good score, and Dinihy has been very effective all afternoon. Maybe things not working out that well for him, but getting that one over the bar.
Yes, Paddy, and there's a very important change that has been made by Rockchapel to try and relieve matters now. John Murphy has come in, a much experienced John Murphy, has replaced Thomas O'Mahony. That's a major change on their part. And John is a player, he's way, way over on the stand side as we look over. He's a player who's seen an awful lot of activity with Rockchapel at junior intermediate county championship level. Must be in his late 30s now, Paddy, and this is a real throw of the dice for them.
Driving forward though, the team captain Philip Murphy. They need score, they need it badly, because there's trail and a scoreline of 7 points to four. But Kishgame rocketed out once again. The Kishgame team that suffered so many heartbreaks down through the years in county championships. Oh, the boot went in there, the referee spotted it, and the free was going to be into the Rockchapel men. But it's further out the field than you'd expect a score from. The man standing over it is Martin Casey. Casey is to go back a little bit further, and he will try to give it a shot. He's given a shot as far as PJ Murphy. PJ Murphy walking his way forward, doing a little bit of a solo run. The tall 6'3" man giving it back as far as Martin Casey. Casey giving it low inside, where it comes now as far as John Murphy. John Murphy laying the ball outside, and an opportunity here for Paul Murphy maybe to get a score. Paul Murphy has a score for the men of Rockchapel. It's their opening score of the second half. It came all of 12 minutes. It's down to two, the margin, 7 points to five, and certainly that score was really, really badly wanted.
It was, Paddy, because it was looking like it was going to be a whitewash there. John Murphy's come in, and I'll tell you, I don't know if you agree with me, but he's buzzing, Paddy. For a man in his late 30s, he's not big, but I'll tell you, he's great guts and character, and he certainly has made a difference and an impact, an immediate impact, since he's come in on young Seamus Murphy, and he's come in there left half forward. Paul Murphy's won this kick out again. He's certainly getting back into it. He's their talisman, Paddy, and he needs to be playing well for Rockchapel to get back into it.
And he's given the ball to the aforementioned John Murphy, the sub, and Murphy dropping it inside. Who's going to run onto this one? It's an Anglin that comes out with it. And there, Kishgame ended the ball now with one of the Kishgame midfielders. The Kishgame midfielder, Christian Padraig O'Leary, very close to the sideline, but still kept in play. He drives it up the field here towards the corner forward line corner, but it's knocked away from him and taken from him with TJ Callaghan. TJ O'Callaghan, gives it to Paul Murphy. Murphy gives it to Casey. Casey looking around the base to see who he's going to give it to. And then Martin Casey giving it low inside. As far as one of the guys who came on, Ian Gainey, Gainey gave it across the field. Can John Murphy keep it in play, I wonder, or can get John Murphy run onto it? But Kishgame have it back, and Ian Gainey's the man that has it. He gives it as far as Paul Murphy. Paul Murphy now leaving the hand pass inside, and Kishgame or Rockchapel now with the person of Anthony O'Donnell. Anthony O'Donnell, the ball taken away, and Kishgame come back as they lead on a scoreline of 7 points to five. 14 minutes gone in the second half here. America and the European doing well in the Ryder Cup, but John Hurley doing well here as he works the ball up forward, but it's cut off once again by Colin Murphy. Colin Murphy, the fullback, let it out the field, and it comes now as far as Martin Casey. They're coming more into the game, but they're finding scores so much harder to get, and then the Kishgame did in the second half, and the free where the ball landed. The free will be taken by Anthony O'Donnell himself, or will he leave it behind for Martin Casey? He'll leave it for Casey. Casey's hoping that John Murphy will turn around, he'll give it to him, or will he decide to leave it in around the danger area right now? Anything can happen. Remember, the wind increasing in tempo as well, and the ball given here towards Guinea. He can't keep it and can't get it because it's taken away from him and running forward. Good play by Bernard Breen, the corner back for the Kishkemen, still driving forward. A hand pass across to a player, maybe not expecting, but that's John Hurley. Bernard Breen went down there, and I'm sure that the referee spotted some little infringement. Bernard Breen went down, and the man being called over from the Rock Chapel side of the fence, if you like, is their left half back, David Murphy. His name is going, well, I'd say his name is definitely going to the Raiders book. Whether his, where his body goes after the discussion or not remains to be seen. And the scoreboard says 7-5. The referee, Donald Roach, checking with him, and well, he doesn't seem to be taking too much notice of it. And I'd imagine that it's probably a yellow card that's going to come after all of that. Yes, a yellow card, and the Kishkemen is still down injured. The Rockchapel people underneath us here are well relieved enough, I'd say, about that particular yellow card. There's no great objecting to it. Wait and see whether Niall Cronin get his third and Kishkemen's 8 point of the game as we come to the halfway stage of the second half. Vital period of time right now. Cronin is kicking. Well, it's heading in the general direction. Do they get inside the post? And the answer is yes. Cronin gets his 4 point of the game. He has 50% of their scores, and they are from frees. And John Finton making the point that with free takers on duty on both sides, Martin Casey has been quite good as well on the Rockchapel side of things. Defenders would not need to be following the referee right up there within. I think that was quite a correct decision, and obviously something was set him, and he moved the ball a little bit into a more advantageous position for the Kishkemen. So now 8 points to 5, 17 minutes gone in the second half. The kick out on its way from the Rockchapel goalkeeper Tony Collins. Oh, caught superbly by midfielder Mossy Leahy. Well, man who came into midfielder Mossy Leahy, and Leahy decided to drive it long inside. Who got in? The PJs underneath it, and he breaks it down. Now who does he break it down to? Freddie is the team captain. He doesn't get it, and a man who's maybe he can get it the second time of asking. That he does. And John Fancy Murphy, the team captain, was trying to watch the ball forward, and he's knocked down, and away come Kishkem. In the person of their right corner back, and James O'Connor has it for them. The Kishkemen going to add to their tally of championships, it would appear. Paul de Goleri is moving the ball up the field. He's run at least 50 or 60 yards, and he gives it back as far as Niall Cronin. And Cronin, lovely chip inside, and away they come once again, and the ball over there, and the man who's picking it up is Donal Hurley. He's already got a point. Hurley's made, we're moving his way forward. They need not foul him now because he gives it back to Niall Cronin. Niall Cronin's attempt at scoring is blocked down there at the expense of a 45, and certainly the Rockchapelmen defending it, their lives depended on it, and that it does, because up in this particular neck of the woods, a junior football medal is really, really treasured, and to hollow one at that. So the Kishkemen in the driving seat as they lead in a scoreline of 8 points to 5. One single point for Rockchapel during this opening 18 minutes of the second half. The selectors on the Kishkem side a little bit happier over there, and their selectors are Michael O'Connor, the former Castle Island Desmonds man. He's their team coach this year, and he's assisted, if you like, in his duties by Peter O'Connell. And of course on this side we have the three-man selection committee, the referee checking his watch, and the free is going to be in to be taken by Paul de Goleri. He is yet to get on the scoring sheet, and so being brought on, I would imagine, because one of the players down injured here for Kishkem, and play held up for another couple of minutes, and there's been quite a few knocks around the place, John, as well.
Yeah, hard but fair, Paddy. I wouldn't say that it's overly done in the foul scene. There's a lot of heavy tackles being thrown in. I think this Bernard Breen's recovering there. Paddy Goleri is this one, Paddy, this 45, and it's going over to the far side. But it's beginning to break down here, Paddy, and Rockchapel have possession coming out.
Rockchapel have possession coming out, but for the moment here with 90 minutes gone, is Kishkem in the driving seat. They lead in the scoreline. Kishkem 8, Rockchapel 5. Back to the studio. Here come the Rockchapel men as they be to come back into this game, and they need to get scores and need to get them badly. 20 minutes now. They've got as far as one of their substitute Guinea moving forward. Then a lovely hand pass off as far as the cornerback TJ O'Callaghan, and TJ looks towards the post. Has he ever kicked towards him, I wonder? And he decides maybe to lay it back to a person who might be better qualified for that particular job, and John Freddie Murphy from the outside of the wall. Can it turn inside? It doesn't turn inside. It looked like that it might in the end, but the game needs a couple of Rockchapel scores right now, John.
They do nearly 20 minutes gone, Paddy, and Sam Sullivan won't be in any hurry with this kick out. That was a nice effort with the outside of the boot by John Francis, and it wasn't just for show he did that, because he was under serious pressure. There were three or four Kiskeam people bearing down him. An awful lot of what's happened in the second half is that Rockchapel kicked an awful lot of ball down the centre of Kiskeam defence and had no one there to collect it, and that happened to Kerry last Sunday, the very, very same thing. But Kiskeam have control. One feels at this stage that Rockchapel would need a goal if they're going to win this game.
And the ball won over there by the evergreen John Murphy, and John Murphy is fouled under the free into Rockchapel. The free to be taken again. It was taken quickly on the 45 metre line, two in from the sideline, and certainly looking around the place to Kiskeam. A low scoring game. When you enjoy the 3-point lead, certainly things looking good for you. 20 minutes and nearly 21 minutes gone now, 9 or 10 minutes to go before, well, who's going to get their hands on this particular trophy? Will it be won back by Morris Anglin, the team captain of Kiskeam, driving it fin side, and the ball wobbling in there. The goalkeeper Sam O'Sullivan collects it. He will look up and then he let it out. It will go very, very close to the sideline. It will go out over the sideline, so it will go back in from this side of the field, 45 metres out. But this time it will go back in from the sideline. It's towards Gainey, the corner forward. He is fouled and the free in. And now the opportunity for a free taker, and whether the who's going to be asked to take this one, running across to take it, a couple of players, but I think the person that's going to finally take up the duty is Anthony O'Donnell. This is a left-footed player, and this calls for a good left-footed player, and certainly Rockchapel will be hoping that this is going to get over the bar. 30 metres out from goal, 4 or 5 metres in from the sideline, a pressure kick. All kicks in this particular championship are pressure, and it's not going to go over the bar, but maybe that something else can accrue from it. Black body seems to have got the hold of it, then Paul Murphy has it. Murphy gives it inside without a pick-up off the ground, the penalty, and I think Morris there was the person in question there, a penalty there, and maybe there was a little inch or two before. I'm not 100% sure that it was really dead buried. It certainly wasn't 2 inches into the ground, but the referee, I won't say fell for it, but John Fitton, you had a real shot from it for this position.
Yes, Paddy, and Tony Collins is travelling the whole distance of the field to take this. I think he is, Matt, in case he has the ball, but I think I'll have to...
Welcome back here, and you've joined us at the most appropriate time. A penalty to Rockchapel, and the man coming up to take it is going to be their goalkeeper, Tony Collins. The penalty resulted from the ball bobbling around the square, and I think it was Morris Angley who put down his hands, and, well, whether it was Morris or not, some Kiskeam man came up with it. Bernard Breen, Bernard Breen is the person that are now saying that did the needful on that occasion. That matters little now, because Tony Collins versus Sam O'Sullivan, the time has come for Collins to deliver, or will it be the time for O'Sullivan to save between the posts? Collins going back to it. The goalkeeper made a long run. He's striking with the right foot, and the save is by Sam O'Sullivan. Is the championship in the hands of Kiskeam right now? Their goalkeeper is out. The hats are down, and certainly that was a rough enough one. Straight at the goalkeeper it went. Sam O'Sullivan held his ground, put his body behind it, and the black and white flags, the checkered flag of Kiskeam, is blowing brightly here right now in Kentork, as they feel that they are on their way to another championship to add to the six they've already won. Coming out of defence is Eamon O'Mahony, the man returned from Australia, getting into the game more and more. He then gives it as far as the full forward, who's had a very good game, Billy Dinehy, right throughout. He gives it to Niall Cronin. The holding up game that gives a very characteristic part of games of Kiskeam in the past will now come into fold, and they give it as far as Eamon O'Mahony, and O'Mahony from way out the field drop it in. The goalkeeper gets a second touch on it. This time he collects it and he works it out the field as far as centre half back. It's going to take some mighty comeback now for Philip Murphy and for the rest of Rockchapel, as they trail in a scoreline of 8-5 with 23 minutes gone. A missed penalty when you've only scored 5. Surely this takes serious heft for them to come back into it. Anthony O'Donnell has it, give the ball across the field, but they get it back once again. It's really a pressure situation. They have a free in the middle of the park. Anthony O'Donnell, he's going to leave the free behind as far as Martin Casey. Casey's already had to take it. Paul Murphy, the free must be taken again as Kiskeam avail of the opportunity to bring in a sub. This will hold you up a little bit, hold up the play a little bit. So Kiskeam bringing in subs, and they're vital to part of the squad system, and the player that's coming in, I think, is the man who was supposed to start early on. That's John Dooney coming in at centre-half forward. So the free now, it's already taken into the hands of Martin Casey, and Casey sort of lovey-dummy there. Can he send it over the bar? Now I wonder, he does send it over the bar, and that's a score that this game in Rockchapel so badly needed. It's now down to 2 points, the margin, 8-6, and certainly that score was so important, because the missed penalty surely had to be a heartbreak for them.
Yes, Paddy, and they've only had 2 points in the second half, and a missed penalty indeed. It's a psychological thing, not to mention the whole matter that they were only down by a goal at the time, and that would have levelled matters. But Sam O'Sullivan has this kick out, 1-1 of Havrock Chapel. The discipline and the wherewithal and the confidence, Paddy, and the self-belief to be able to come back into it in these last 5 minutes.
Now it's Rochchapel in one position again with the team captain John Francis. Freddy House Murphy giving it to PJ Murphy, who's been good all day. PJ decides he's going to have a right blast off. This one's heading for a solo, and then he gives a pass inside to a man who's got a great point, Martin Casey, a couple of minutes ago. What's Casey going to do now? They need not foul him, and Martin Casey then give it off as far as the team captain John Freddy, give it inside, and PJ misses it at the final time, and away come Kish game. That was a let off, really. The ball out the field again. Paul Murphy has it over there when he thought he had it. The ball bobbling behind him. Who's going to run onto it? It's the Rochchapel men again, as they trail in a scoreline of 8-6. John Murphy, the sub, has it. The evergreen sub, they tell me about this particular guy. And then he gives it back as far as Martin Casey. Casey then laying it off to a corner back. Conor Guiney. Guiney give it inside, and the pass went astray, and there'll be a free out and probably a little bit of paperwork once again. And Rochchapel really now need the scores, but the clock winding down. 26 minutes gone. 4 minutes left in it. 2 points between the sides. 8-6. Kish game in the lead. And of course that penalty, well, I suppose John Fintan will be talked about for a while, no doubt, in the world.
Yeah, or it will, Paddy, but you know, one wonders about that penalty. I'm not really sure that player would just have touched it on the ground, but Kish game has certainly worked their lead. They have a 3-point lead, Paddy, and I think it's a 2-point lead at this stage, but they need to settle down at this stage, and there's no team better or more experienced than that from Kish game to be able to do that. Sam Sullivan has this off the hand, Paddy, and certainly Rochchapel are going to find it very tough to break this lead down.
Sam Sullivan there taking all the time in the world, and now Kish game back with the initiative once again. The man that has it is John Anglin. John Anglin loses it, and Rochchapel win it back there, playing some good football with the last 5 or 6 minutes. Now they have a free. The free is taken over there. Who's going to win it? The man that's, well, I thought a man was going to win it, but he has now, and that's Conor, not Conor Geaney, but James O'Connor. Right, Conor back for Kish game. He works it out the field, and away come Kish game. And this one could be dangerous as it drops inside, but it's cut out, and there was a hand winning over the shoulder there, but the referee says to play advantage. What have we got? Ballinhassig 1-3, Carrigaline a point. 16 minutes into the southeast the southeast final down there. Remember, when this game is over, we're on our way to Milford for what should be an absolute cracker, the North Cork Junior Hurling Championship between Drumina and Charleville. Charleville, the champions, did so well in last year's county final, but it's Kish game will lead here on a scoreline of 8-6. Rochchapel, though, have the lion's share of possession in the last couple of minutes, but don't let us fool you, because early on Kish game were the dominant side. The wide tally was about 7 or 8 to 1 or 2. Kish game, Rochchapel now, doing a little bit of overpassing, and the man that has it here is playing a mighty game, and that's Martin Casey. I spoke too soon, and he gives the ball away, and away comes the Donny Anglin, I think, is the player in question as he comes out of centre half-back. Good play by Anglin, laying it off to wing forward John Anglin. Brothers spotting each other. It's a day about brothers, it's a day about pride, and it's a day about Kish game winning back the championship. And they work forward in the person of their midfielder, Paul de Goleri, soling it up, holding it up. It comes now to Niall Cronin. Niall Cronin, a great man in doing the job, and he gives it to another man who was arriving to see him, Eamon O'Mahony, doing his solo. He was going to lay it off, and then he decides that he's going to lay it off to the far side of the field over there. And running onto it is the corner forward. That's Donal Hurley, who got a point early on. Hurley could win this game. He plays it as far as a man who's done so well, and he laid it off, and the shot comes there, and the game is over. A goal coming from David O'Leary after a brilliant work by Billy Dinahy, the full forward. So Rochchapel's day in the sun is definitely out of the way now. As Kish game, with 28 minutes gone, getting the all-important they'll talk about in the morning. They'll mention two situations, but certainly that one was well and truly finished to the back of the net. Great work by the man who got it, but brilliant work by Billy Dinahy here as well, John.
Yeah, very good goal, but it was coming for a long time. David O'Leary eventually finished it, and he was always going to be dangerous in any situation like that. Donny Hurley, he did the spade work for his party, got it on eventually, passed it to David O'Leary. It was Billy Dinahy got it. Great distributor of the ball, Billy Dinahy. A beautiful pass to David O'Leary, very well weighted. And at this late stage, Kish game will bring on a sub, I suppose. There's more for the matter of giving a guy a run at this stage. I think they're making a substitution, but the goal needed to come from Rochchapel at the other end. But instead of that, as often happens in games like this, it was Kish game got the goal, and You know, you can say good night to the result of the game. There's no doubt about it. It's only a matter of playing time out. But certainly Kiskeam on the play party in a number of wides would be by far the better team. Having possession and getting a lot of wides doesn't often guarantee success, of course, but they survived from that point of view. And I suppose at the end of the day, Rochtaple's inability to convert possession when they had chances coming forward has proved their undoing.
Yes, indeed, and with the referee just checking his watch, we can tell you that there's very, very little time left in this one. But Rochtaple, to their credit, keep fighting back, and it's cut off inside by an England as they walk it out the field to one of the men who will get a chance to impress right now. That's Dennis O'Leary. So the subs getting an opportunity to buy their time and come down as far as Niall Cronin, the man who got 4 points in this match. They were important scores earlier on. The scoreboard now reading, though, 1-8 to 6 points, and certainly the goal so vital. This man had a great Duhalla final as well, that big, tall, young full forward. Always linking up with other players around him, a most unselfish player, Paul Murphy, doing his little bit for the men of Rochtaple. They play it out at the very end, as we'd expect men from the Rochtaple would do, and working forward now, the ball going astray once again, and it's now coming to the person of Declan Crimmin, the Kiskeam left halfback. Kiskeam playing it forward, and it comes now as far as David O'Leary, a goal and 2 points in this particular championship. The referee looks at his watch, and when the referee looks at his watch for the second time, he's already after doing it. This game is on its way to the inevitable end, since that game the goal went into the back of the net. Niall Cronin has it now. If he kicked the ball in, the referee checking, and there's 31 minutes gone, and the ball now in the hands of Declan Crimmin. They're playing it shot, they're playing it everywhere they want to, but they're making sure that they don't lose possession. Now coming forward is their corner back, James O'Connor still moving forward, and they lay it back as far as Dinahy. And to be nice, if Dinahy get on the scoring app, because he set up players left, right, centre around him all day, and he gives it back to a corner back, and James O'Connor, the corner back, will probably kick the ball for the last time in this Duhallow Jonah Football Championship, and it will mean that Kiskeam are to be crowned champions for the seventh time in their history, winning it back in 64, 94 and 96, 97 and 99 and 2000. And on a number of those occasions, they went along to go to the county championship final. But on each of those occasions, they were beaten. They were deserving victors today, no doubt in the world about that, John.
Yeah, they were the better side, Paddy. You often wonder, from their own point of view, they must have often worried about the number of chances they got that they didn't convert. I make it that in the end, Paddy, they had about 10 wides. They also had a 45 that wasn't converted, whereas Rochtaple, I think, in fact, had only about 3 wides altogether. Granted, they did miss the penalty, but from that point of view, Kiskeam were by far the better team. They had more possession, they should have converted a lot more. They did win it in the end, 1-8-6. Purely from an objective point of view, disappointing game in so far, as the scores are very hard and few to come by. But Kiskeam were the better side. They won't worry about the game, the way the game looked. The result is everything to them, and they're back in the county championship campaign again, Paddy. They were certainly the better side, and deserving winners of this championship.
So they're the thoughts of John Fintan Daly for the moment. And now, of course, it's on to a coverage of the presentation of the Cup, which was really going to be a really great occasion for the men of Kiskeam.
I wish on behalf of the Duhallow Board, first of all, to thank our sponsors for their magnificent sponsorship of this, our Duhallow Junior Championship. As you all know, as you can see on this banner behind us, Boherby have contributed enormously to this championship. No, there's no mic in it anyway. And now it is my privilege to hand you over to the Vice Chairman of Boherby Co-op, Mr. Tim Murphy.
Thank you, Jerry. All I can say is that we're delighted to be involved and with the sponsors of this competition. And it's quite an enjoyable game, good sporting game. And we look forward to a long and fruitful association with the board in the future. That's it.
Thank you, Tim. And now it is my privilege again to, I think, in fairness, congratulate both teams for a very competitive game of football. There is no doubt, of course, that we thoroughly enjoyed this game because of the closeness of the contest itself. And I'd like to congratulate, and indeed, I suppose, sympathise with Rochtaple too, because I think, having won it last year, they had the confidence, I'd say, of most of the division that probably they might be able to put two in a row together. But however, Kiskeam had different ideas. Before we present the trophy, I would like in particular to thank the Kentor Club for the magnificent condition of this pitch here today and for their organisation of the fixture. Thank you very much, Count Hirk. I feel too that our referee here today deserves our gratitude and indeed congratulations. Yeah. Morris said there, bring down the rain, but I think we should offer our thanks to God for giving us such a magnificent day here today and kept the rain away for so long for us. I would like to take this opportunity as well of wishing Kiskeam well, because now, Kiskeam, it's about time you went on and won a county. And maybe give other teams in Duhalla a chance of winning a junior championship. But you deserve our congratulations and thank you for the vast contribution both teams have made to this competition. And now it is my privilege on behalf of the Duhalla board to present your captain, Morris England, with the trophy.
The first words I say is, the Blacks are back! Yeah! I think we all can remember back 2 months ago, Kiskeam were knocked out of the championship by Mill Street, and we thought that was it for 2002. But for the backdoor system, you don't give Kiskeam a second chance, and today we are back! Yeah! I would like especially to thank all the players who have given tremendous effort for the whole year. We started back in February through the rain, the sands in Banna Beach, and the effort has really, truly paid off here today. So I'd really like to thank every player for all their effort. I would like to thank a lot of people. I would like to thank our sponsors. I'd like to thank everyone involved in the club, helping everyone along the way. I would like to thank Borrowby Co-op for sponsoring the championship. I would like to thank Kentor, Bally Desmond, Bantier for the use of their football field. And I would really like to thank two men who were after putting in some tremendous effort for the whole year. One of them is Peter O'Connell, a true and true Kiskeam man. And I think we're after finding another man. He might have been disappointed last Sunday, but I think today this made up for it, and that's the Mike O'Connor. And all I can say is, true to Rock Chapel, they're never beaten, and they're true champions. And all I can say is, he'll be back next year, lads. And three cheers for the Rock. Hip hip. Hip hip. Hip hip. That's it, lads.
Watch the lead now, let's watch the lead. I'm delighted. What more could I say? It is the culmination of all the years of success. To beat the Rock is something special. We beat them in 96. And we've done it again now today, and I think it proves that we're a brilliant team. And I don't say that lightly.
Yeah, that is the case. What do you think are the main contributory factors only to the win itself?
Oh, I thought it's hard to pick out a man, but I thought Patrick Leary had a brilliant game along with Eamon Meheny in centre field. But it's hard to be picking anyone. I thought the whole 15 and the subs used, they all put in a massive effort.
That's right. They seem to be very balanced side, all right. And maybe a let off with the penalty there close to the end.
Definite, which was a great save by Sam. He kept his cool, and as they always do. And once it went up the field, and once we got the goal, it was all over then. But I think the final scoreline reflected our superiority overall in the game.
Coming into the conversation now, Donny will be the prospects for the county championship.
Would want to come back to me in a few nights' time, maybe, or something, because tonight we're not worrying about the county. We're just going out for a big night, and we'll think about that in a few nights' time, but hopefully we hope to do well.
It was tough going out, isn't it? Been took all the way. Rockchapel, they're never beaten. They're just keep coming back and coming back, and they had the penalty, and if they had scored it, it might be a different story. But we got our break, got lucky, and we finished up, we got the goal the other end, and we got a few scores, and we just held on then for the last few minutes. It's a very tough team to get over at any stage, and we knew that, But
They are a tough side. You seem to be in the driving seat for most of the game, but it could be said that you made hard work of it.
We did. We had about, I think someone said there, we had about 11 wides in the first half, and I'd say we had maybe 5 or 6 more in the second half. All those things happen. We had the same thing against Borby. We were in control for a lot of the game, but we never put it away. At least we took enough to get through anyway. These things happen. There's a tricky little wind out there, especially playing in the first half the way we were playing, and the ball was kind of taking it out towards the sideline, and it's hard to score there. It came a bit better for us in the second half. We took some nice scores, and we finished up. We did enough to win anyway, at least. Thanks be to God.
It looks like a very balanced side, David, and a very strong panel. The prospects for the county championship looks good.
Well, we've thought that a few more times. We won't take anything for granted. I don't know who we're playing next now, but we won't. Every game is a tough game in the county championship. We know that through experience. We have a good side this year. Mikey's come in there. He's done very, very well for us, and we're all delighted, really. We have a very fit panel, and we're very strong, and we've trained in Benny Beach earlier in the year, it's all stood to us, we've 5 or 6 more fillers there on the line who would be just as good if they came in, we've plenty of strength and depth, and John Hurley was out for the semi-final there, one of our key men, and we played as if he wasn't there. He actually turned out that we played just as well without him, he came in today and did a fantastic job for as long as he could. He got injured there at the end, but please God, we get the breaks this year. It's all a bit of luck too, and hopefully it'll come our way.
Well, I'm delighted, absolutely delighted for the Kishkem football team. They put in a ferocious effort all season, and listening to the lads and talking to the lads, they were working fierce hard on it, and I'm delighted for them. Today's game was a tough game, and that's what you would expect from Rockchapel. Rockchapel have always been a very good, traditionally good side, and put in a ferocious effort and commitment to their GA club, and they fought hard on the field there, and at times it was anybody's game, but Kishkem pulled away. I suppose the crucial point, with the Sam saving of the penalty, and after that then we got a goal, and we capitalised on that. But I'm commiserated with Rockchapel. They won it last year. They're a good side, and they contribute greatly to GAA throughout the Duhallow region. But again, congratulations to all our lads, and particularly to the lads that played today, and all the lads, the backroom team and everything else. They put in a ferocious effort, and well done to Kishkem.
In the first half, it was very tight. I felt we probably should have scored more. We should have been well on top at half-time. But in the second half, we just knuckled down and started playing our normal game, passing it and kicking the ball properly, and we got our scores in the end. And fair play to Sam for saving the penalty.
He seemed to be very cool under pressure. He looked like a very balanced side, and the experience of the past, with 8 or 9 years, seems to be coming to the fore, and it's a great advantage for the team.
Well, it is. Fairness, though, Mike has brought in confidence into the team, and we're confident on the ball, and good going forward, and we don't panic when we're under pressure. When Rockchapel put it up to us there, we kind of got going and got our vital scores in the end. The goal really killed them, I thought. So.
How do you feel the prospects now for the county championship are?
We'll celebrate this now, and we'll worry about the county and training next week. So we're not worried about the moment. We'll talk to you in the morning about the county.
I suppose we had an awful lot of misses in the first half. I don't know how we'll probably be down to, but I thought we were kind of shooting faster. We didn't work the ball in. We were shooting far out, and it suited the rock. When we were shooting, they were blocking us down, and I suppose at the end of the day, the couple of scores came to us, and we just availed them, and... Overall, I thought Kishkem were a superior team, but we just didn't take our scores.
And the penalty was probably a turning point as well.
It was. It was, I suppose you must give credit to Sam for stopping him on the stopper penalty, fair play. But I thought it was a very poorly struck penalty. But having said that, the game was over after that shot. Yeah. That the rock, the heads went down and we just upped the gear and we take down a few pints and that was that was about it.
The goal was beautifully executed. I thought it was a great sign of the team. It was a patient build-up and it was probably slow, but the lads obviously knew what they were doing.
They did. We held up the ball and we went into space, we threw around a few passes and David O'Leary, fair play, he stuck it away. There was no stop of it.
It was a beautiful finish.
Great, great, great score. The game was over before that, but that really finished the game as a contest.
The county championship, Tom, that'll be on the lips of everybody now.
It is. We have a good team. We have a good team. Conditions, I suppose, will change, and there'll be horses for courses, I suppose, and we're going well, so we'll have to take it one match at a time, and I think he's coming in great chance.
We were all on top, but we weren't getting the scores, and of course, Rockchapel are so dogged. They are Rockchapel. They're easily beaten, and they proved that today. You know, they kept fighting away. They survived in scraps and crumbs in the first half, and they were level at half-time. I know they came out in the second half there, and I know we had a good start to the second half, but they came back into the game big time in the second half, and, you know, we were delighted to hit the final whistle, I can assure you.
Certainly, Tom. It's a very balanced side, Tom, and a very strong panel. The prospects for the county championship should look very good.
Oh, yeah, certainly. I think we'll give it one last this year. You know, I'm disappointed for a lot of the players who can't get on the team and who could be on the team, and I suppose they'd be on any other team in the county. Yeah. We have tremendous players on the bench, and, you know, you could bring on any one of them. You know, who knows, they might be needed yet. You're only as strong as your weakest link, and our subs are very strong, and they've all trained very hard all the year, and they're very fit. And I think some of them are actually fitter than they ever were. So, you know, it's disappointing for them that they can't be on, but they can't say anything about the fellas they are on. They're doing the business, and we can't say no more than that.
The players seem to gel very well together, and they have a great understanding of each other. Peter Connell and Mike O'Connor seem to have an outstanding job done with them.
Oh, I'm not about that. They have brought a new freshness definitely to the team, and Mike, I think Mike has been tremendous. He's a great motivator, and he's a great way with the players, and I think, you know, he's done very well this year with them, and in a professional approach, I think a lot of credit must go to Mike for what he's done, and of course Peter is a great stalwart, and thanks to Peter, he's always been there when we need him.
Well, I thought they played very well. Like, they seemed to be in there from the start, and they should have rocked up at half-time. I thought maybe if the Rock got the penalty, maybe they'd have come back, but I couldn't see them coming back.
Yeah, they looked like a very balanced side, Christy, and the backs were outstanding.
And I thought Paddy Glary had a fierce game at the field.
Yeah.
He was catching ball and delivering it and doing great work with it. Like.
They seem to have an excellent understanding of each other, and the execution of the goal demonstrated that very well.
I came across the field, Alec, and just seemed very well across, and Dolan won it, and he set up his man for it. I thought it was very well worked. Like.
Would you be confident of a county title this year, Christy?
We're happy as it is. Yeah. We're very happy as it is. Yeah. We settle for small things.
Yeah. But they are a very balanced side, and it will take a good team to beat them, I think.
It will take a great team to beat them. It will take a great team to beat them. Because they're playing good football, and I thought it was a great, clean game today.
Yeah.
You know, there was no physical work of any significance in it today.
That's right.
We seemed to be in control of the game. We were the few points up, but we weren't pretty on the board, and suddenly they got what looked like the opportunity to come right back into it. I felt if the Rock scored the penalty, they'd possibly go on to win it. But thankfully, Sam saved it, and then we got the goal shortly after, so that took the pressure off.
Certainly, the backs were very strong all the way through, and it never looked like the Rockchapel forwards were going to make any serious inroads, given the tightness of their marking.
Yeah, really. Some of the backs in general were outstanding. I thought Morris, full back. Bernard Breen was outstanding, cornerback. Donny Englund, of course, I thought had a tremendous game. He made so many bursts up the field. You know, he turned defence into attack so many times like that. I thought Donny had a tremendous game.
They play a lovely brand of football, Brendan. Their understanding seems to be excellent, and they seem to have a style where they work the ball really well out of defence, and the finishing seemed to be good, bar there was a bit of bad luck in the first half today.
Yeah, that's a feature of our backs play all through the season, that their ability to work the ball out of defence is top class. And it is a thing, I have seen him training pretty often. And it is a thing that working a lot in training, Mike O'Connor, it is one of the things he's got him. There's great credit due to Mike O'Connor, of course. It is one of the things he's got him doing. Anytime I see him on the field, like, it is one of the things he's always emphasising, not to kick it out foolish. And it is really paying off in games this year, like. As you say, at the other end of the field, our forwards didn't play as good as usual. They played good up to a point, but missed a lot of scores, all right, but I suppose they got enough from them to make it count, yeah.
Niall, it was an excellent win.
Oh, tremendous, tremendous. We're delighted. After last year, we were really determined this year to try and come back and win the championship. Because I think a lot of teams probably thought we could have been gone or over the hill, like, and we're still to bits now. All the hard work paid off, really, and we're very happy today, you know.
With the exception of probably some of the poor finishing today, Niall, it was an outstanding performance. The ball was worked very well out of defence. Centre field were very strong, and the forwards seemed to have an excellent understanding of each other.
Yeah. We controlled the ball well, in fairness, though, but we didn't put the scores on the board. Like, I suppose we're all guilty of that. Like, but it was very tense today. Like, there was a lot of tension out there. We were happy. We kind of killed the game at the end. We held on to the ball. We didn't kick it away foolishly. Like, and we're happy with that, really.
Yeah, I know it's probably a difficult question and an unfair question in many ways, but you'll probably, given the performance during this campaign, go into the county campaign as, well, maybe not favourites, but as strong contenders.
Yeah, well, definitely, yeah. We'll enjoy this now for a few days and we'll get back to hard training. I suppose we've been there a few times and we've been there 3 times. I suppose if you knock on the door long enough, we'll have to come in sometime. Like, I suppose I proved that last weekend, but we'll be big team up for it, like, when... We know we're as good as any team that's out there, and we're going to give it one hell of a shot to try and bring it back to this game.
Yeah, I think, you know, I mean, there was a lot of people saying to me there at halftime that we should have been up maybe 5 or 6 points, that we should have scored a goal. I mean, the most important thing for us is that we kept our focus all the way through the game. We went into the second half, we still kept winning. Our backs were absolutely brilliant. I've never seen them playing better. Our centre field, we still dominated the game, even though, okay, we were missing, fair enough. But the tension out there, like, we're sitting back, looking at it, it's grand for us to talk out in the stand. But, I mean, the tension was unreal, like, you know. So, I mean, it's important to realise that the tension of the game and the amount of, you know, the rivalry between the Rock and Kish game is, you know, it goes back a long way, like. So, I mean, it was vital for us. 1 point was enough, like. But, I mean, we were probably a bit lucky, too. The ball that broke from Paul Murphy there to Morris.
Yeah.
And the miss of the penalty, like. But at the end of the day, we took our chances when they came and we won. What did we win by? What did we win by? 4 points.
It was 4 points. Or was it 5 points?
Four points.
Well, I mean, Paddy.
1 point is grand.
Yeah.
Well, Paddy, the thing is where the cup is going.
That's true. Yeah. They play a lovely brand of football, Paddy. They bring it out nicely out of defence.
Even when the pressure was on, they held their shape. Our wing stayed out, our corner forward stayed inside, which was absolutely important for us. Like, and we were breaking away the ball at centre field. Any ball we didn't win, we were picking up great breaks. And the backs were... I mean, I couldn't say enough about the backs. They were absolutely superb, you know.
It's a very balanced side, Paddy. The panel is very strong. They should go into the county championship as strong contenders.
Every game is a game. They're all saying, oh, it's about time Kiskeam won a county, but that's unfair pressure too, like, you know, in a young team, you know.
Yeah.
So, I mean, they'll... Every game is a game to be won. Like, you have to win the next game, and that's what it's all about.
Carl, coach of the Rockchapel football team. Tom, the penalty was a turning point.
Oh, definitely. We had been playing poor all the game and we were just getting a bit of a few breaks at the time, and probably if we had scored the penalty, it could have been, you know, the stat we needed. There was about 5 or 6 minutes left in the game and maybe we could have got that point to win the game.
I thought Rockchapel worked the ball well up to their own half-forward line and moves seemed to break down after that. The Kiskeam back seemed to be marking very tight.
Oh, definitely. The Kiskeam back line were super today. Our fellas found it hard to win the first time ball, and when we did, if we delayed on the ball, they crowded us out and we failed to take any scorable chances. We didn't even, some of our guys found it hard to take a shot for a score.
There's always great rivalry, Tom, between Kiskeam and Rockchapel. It was a great, clean, competitive game of football.
Oh, definitely. I don't think there was a dirty tackle in the whole game, one or two yellow cards, but... you know, overall, it was a fine sporting game, and you know, Kiskeam have turned out a fine bunch of fellas, and all they're interested in is playing football, and you know, I'm sure that they'll rattle the county this time.
You'll be back again next year, Tom. You've had a great couple of years, victory in the final last year, runners up this year.
It's hard to keep coming back. You know, it takes just the same effort to get to the final and lose it as it does to win it, and. you know, it's very hard to keep the thing going and keep fellas around, and you know, in a small rural place,
yeah,
you know.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So hopefully we will, maybe not next year, maybe again the year after. Yeah.